Can you start by telling us, for each of you, what it is about the story of Carlos Acosta that is so unique and so important to be explored?
Well, there is kind of lots of things. I mean, what struck me is how not to tell this story more than the reasons to tell it. There is the most obvious, which is, to me, when I start reading his autobiography, which is a kid that didn't want to dance. To me, that was the first shock. For a guy who have get to be a star in the Royal Ballet, which is one of the four main companies in the world. So how come he didn't want to dance, and how was that process to find it, his way through it? Then there was the relationship with his dad, then the fact that he was from this very poor background in Havana and again ends up at the heart of London and in the Royal Ballet. Carlos is a Cuban. Probably he wouldn't have done it if he wasn't, because it's only there you could find a kid like this from that background being taught ballet, which is again an elitist learning. So there were so many things. Carlos is 40 odds. His life has been parallel to the life in Cuba in the last 40 years, which has been fascinating as well. And then it allowed us to explore a side of Cuba which is not that often in films, which is the artistic side. I mean, there is so much talent in Cuba. We explore the dance, but there is film, there is literature, there is music. I mean, you really get amazed at the level of talent there. So it had all these possibilities to explore through telling the life of Carlos.
Carlos is a remarkable human being. Can you talk a little bit about working with him in adapting, obviously, his autobiography and I guess just how you approach handling such intensely personal and sensitive subject matter as some of the elements of this story?
Yeah, well, they're all very good questions, and in a way you never really know until you actually work with someone how that's going to work out. But his autobiography was obviously, that gave me a great deal of factual information. But just when we met, we just felt that there was an openness there, and I think he just trusted us. So he didn't interfere at all. He was just very, very open. So I'm greatly relieved now. He's happy with the film, and it was a lovely experience to bring the film back to Havana, 5,400 people at the Karl Marx Cinema with another couple of thousand outside, and for them to feel that this was, you know, not only their story of their son. You know, because they view him with great affection, but they felt this is a story of Cuba as well. So it was, you never know, and especially when it's a different language, a different culture, I mean, you approach it with great caution. And but, you know, we worked very hard just listening to people, you know, studying the history, and then trying to find out, you know, what are the best moments in his life to try and capture, you know, such a rich life.
And I think, obviously, for the world, Carlos is first and foremost a beautiful dancer. I'm curious if you can talk about striking the balance with this film between exploring that side of performance and dance, which is obviously what people are often very fixated on, and at the same time exploring all these rich layers of culture and his personal journey.
Well, I think that's Paul's job in the script. He very fast spotted the fact that Carlos is the descendant of slaves. And I mean, it was in the book that the presence of the book is dedicated to his dad. So the presence of the dad is, from the very beginning, is very strong there. But then what that means, what it means to be a descendant of slaves, and how the father lived through that, and his pride, and his... he was a very dignified man, a very strong black man, very aware of his roots. And that scene is actually a fiction, the scene in which he tells his son about it, but it was in his character, it was in the spirit of the father, that sense of, this is where we come from, and that's important you remember, because we're fighters, we are... So I think that was very well spotted in the script from the very beginning from Paul, and he made it like the main spine in the story, that a descendant of slaves ends up doing a black Romeo in the Royal Ballet, and that is an amazing journey. So I guess that was...
And I think your question is interesting too, because, you know, we can enjoy dance, you know, there's a certain kind of, you know, performance in it, and you can be consumed by it's so spectacular sometimes, but after a while you want story. So the thing was really, could we, you know, turn the dance into part of the story so it becomes part of the narrative, you know, and that was a big bit. So Iciar did a lot of really good work with with a Catalan choreographer,
Maria Rovira, who did the choreographies in the film.
And so that was really important, that, you know, so we see dance, but also in that dance you're having story instead of just a kind of a little period of break from the narrative. So to try and make that one piece and make it organic, I suppose that was the big challenge, because it's one thing to write it, but another thing is to actually do it and make it seem seamless.
And there is another thing I really like about the approach Paul did in the script, which was we see a lot of the rehearsals, we see a lot of the work it means. We don't see full theatres with applause and the success. We know that because Carlos is still very successful, but it's actually the cost of it, the sacrifice it implies. I really wanted to go for that, for seeing the sweat and the effort and the hours and hours they have to dedicate. I mean, there is no way to get that far unless you push yourself to the very limit. And that's part of the life of dancers and dancers like Carlos. And that's another bit of the film, is no big theatres, full. They are empty because they are working still. So.
Well, we hope people fill the theatres to watch the beautiful film. And thank you so much for talking to us about it. It's a pleasure.